I would like to consider the integration of knowledge coming from different mind faculties and its application in grasping the social reality. In approaching social reality, different mind faculties, starting from different standpoints, create conceptual frameworks, create diverse conceptual frameworks. Each of these frameworks is valid within certain limits, but none of them grasp the complete social reality. Society is supposed to work as an organized system, providing grounds for the preservation and the evolution of humanity. However, to understand individual and collective social process, we need to go beyond the analytical capacity of our mind. Life situations can't be grasped only by analysis, synthesis, and abstraction. So, which new ways of using our mind can help us encompass the phenomenal field we call social reality? How can diverse mind faculties such as rationality, intuition, creativity, and sensitivity complement each other in a harmonious unity of a working mind? Society is a heterogeneous organization that cannot be understood and governed as a whole through separate conceptual frameworks. Only the result of integration of these frameworks can bring us closer to the knowledge necessary to encompass and understand social reality. Therefore, I think that the recognition of the importance of different mind faculties and the integration of the resulting knowledge is crucial for a successful approach in social research. I would like to give my two examples. One is actually the way we approach the tangible and the intangible. In society, when we try to understand society, we analyze the structure, the institutions, something that we can rationally analyze, sympathize, and reproduce. But what makes the society evolve over time and progress is the intangible part. It's the human beings correctly give dynamism to this structure, and I think that the methods which we use to analyze the tangible and the intangible cannot be the same. I think simply we use different mind faculties to approach the intangible and tangible. And the second example. It's closer to me. I was recently in the Shaolin Temple in China, mm-hmm. where young boys come at the age of 5, 6, and 7, and then they are educated to be, and they're educated to be kung fu monks. So develop their body through the practice of kung fu. They practice Chan Buddhism, and they live in a monastery. However, they are not monks, and they don't have any kind of obligations, for example, I think they don't have any kind of vows or religious, religious vows to take. They're completely free, but they're simply educated in this environment. So, because I'm interested in body practice, so I had a chance to meet one of the Kung Fu monks. He's a boy, 23 years old, and I was asking him, since he has a 15-year-long education in this practice, and the things that they learn in school is the body practice, the Chan Buddhism, and then the reading, writing, and some basic calculus. So I was trying to ask him, okay, well, when you kick, how do you kick? Do you lift your leg, and then you bend your knee, and then you kind of slap? Or how do you do it? And then with a fist in the same, and when you breathe, when you run, please explain to me in a way that I can understand it. And he couldn't understand what I was asking him. For him, kick is a kick, and punch is a punch, and he cannot decompose this concept of kick as I'm used to and as I'm taught to. So his way of learning, as I understood it, is more in layers. First he learns how to kick, and then through constant repetition, he goes into some kind of what he would describe as a deeper understanding of a simple movement. So this is just one example of different kinds of knowing, of the same thing, but a completely different approach, which makes the two of us talking about the same thing, both passionate about it, in a way that we can't really understand each other.